The day that we put our faith in Jesus as our Lord and confessed Him as our Lord and thereby took that blood and smeared it upon the doorposts of our heart, we became, just like the people of Israel, a protected people, a blood-marked people whom God protects.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my Lord thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross.
We used to hear terminology such as this: there is victory in the name of Jesus. Keep repeating it all the time. I've seen it. I never understood it that much in those days, but I could tell that these people knew something about it. Little bit of knowledge was there concerning that. That's why they were saying it, and they were seeing a lot of victory through that, you know. But there are some people that also used it more like a magical word, or magical wand, so to speak, you know. They'll try to use that so that something will happen. That is not the way you should understand it, because that means you use the word, but you don't really understand it. I've seen a lot of people that will say, victory in the blood of Jesus, and then they will turn around and they'll say how they are unworthy and dirt and worm and nothing. Now, if the blood of Jesus has been shed for you, and like the Bible says, it washes you clean and makes you white as snow, leaves no dirt behind, how can you call yourself unworthy, dirty, filthy, and no good, and rotten, and all that? You can't. These two things don't go together. That betrays the fact that these people are saying things because somebody else is saying it, but they don't understand it. You see, there are people like that I've seen. They say on the one hand, something about the blood of Jesus, literally pleading the blood. But on the other hand, they will be saying things like this that completely betrays the fact that they don't even believe what the blood of Jesus has done for them. What's the use of saying there is victory in the blood when you don't even believe that victory and show that victory in the way that you speak about your problems? So I'm talking about not about you using this thing as a magical word that you let out every time you want every time you're in danger or something. No, I'm talking about a knowledge and how to use it effectively in your life as a confession of your heart. Fill your heart with that knowledge so that in every moment of your need, this matter comes up before you. You are like that lawyer who knows what is guaranteed to you by the blood, and you make your plea and plead the blood in that situation in that way. You know. So I want to talk about this matter of pleading the blood and how we can do that in our lives and so on. Now, there are four things that took place in that ancient event of Passover in Exodus chapter 12, when the first Passover was observed. Four things that happened. And those four things have unmistakable direct application for us today. So I picked out those four things. I want to concentrate on that. And I want to show you how you can look at those four things that really happened to those people and understand that these are really the four things that really happens to us also. That was the shadow. Ours is real. And how we can plead the blood in various situations based on the four things that we see here in that old event. All right? So let's look at the four things quickly. That's all the sermon is about today. Number one is the blood provided protection. The blood of the Passover lamb provided protection. Now, you remember the Passover event. We already went through it. But let me just quickly in 1 minute say that. See, the people of Israel were in bondage in Egypt. They were slaves, troubled greatly by Pharaoh and his people. They were there 430 years. Out of that, 70 years were good. 360 years, they went through problems. The intensity of their problem increased as the years went by. Finally, in Moses' time, it amounted to that Pharaoh ordering the midwives to kill all the children that are born as male children. Such was the persecution. Literally, they were killing kids as they were born. Not wanting a Jewish race. They want the Jewish race to be extinct, you know, in the future. Because they're prospering. They're increasing in number, doing very well. So they troubled them in every way. They made them slaves. They made them work hard. Paid them very little. Made them poor and useless, literally, in their poverty, in slavery, they became a people that lost all hope. For 360 years, imagine being in poverty. And God comes to their aid. Why he comes? Because he's made a blood covenant with Abraham, their forefather, and told Abraham that he will give a son to him. At that time, Abraham was without a child. And he was literally lamenting before God. He was saying to God, what have you given me? And I have everything, but my servants' children are going to possess all my wealth. I have so much wealth. They're going to walk away with it because I don't have a son. And God comforts him saying, no. There will be a son born to you. A son born to you. And he will become your descendant. And he will inherit everything that you have, not your servants' children. And he guarantees him that a son will be born to him. So he takes him out and shows him the stars of the sky and says, count, can you number them? And Abraham looks at it. And sure enough, the answer is no. And God says, so will your seed be. To a childless man who is approaching 100 years of age, God tells him, like the stars of the sky, innumerable, so will your seed be. Second thing he guarantees him is that he shows a land. He says, this land that you've come into, I will give you this land, not only to you, but to your seed, which is Isaac, the proper seed, the legitimate seed. To you and to your seed forever, I will give you this land, God says. So two things. One, to a childless man, child, and a great number of descendants. And two, a land is going to give. And Abraham says, wait a minute, this is too much. I don't even have one son. And you're saying, you'll give me a seed like the stars of the sky. And I don't own anything. I left everything and came because you called. And you say you'll give me the whole land, not just a few acres. By what can I know that you will do this for me? So God says, bring some animals and birds and all that. Cut them into two pieces. and lay them here. And when he cut them into two pieces and laid them, God made a covenant with him. A blood covenant. A blood covenant. Very meaningful covenant. I went through that when I talked about the blood covenant. That event in chapter 15 of Genesis is very important. God is making a blood covenant with a man. Literally, God is saying, hey, I'm God. I'm Almighty God. My resources are available to you. I can do all things. Don't think of me in an ordinary way. You don't worry about how you don't have a child and how you're getting old and all that. Because you're dealing with Almighty God. And I'm entering into a covenant with you. I will do what I said. I will fulfill this need of your life. I will do what I said. I am able to do it. I'm able to give you a child and a seed that is more than the stars of heaven. And I'm able to give you this land. I will do what I said. God made a blood covenant with Abraham. And when he made the blood covenant with Abraham, he told him, your descendants that come through Isaac, there'll be so much in number. They will go into Egypt and there they will grow and become great in number. And they'll be persecuted. They'll serve. They will be slaves, literally. He told them 400 years before God told them what is going to happen to them in Egypt. They'll serve them for 400 years. That serve means slave under them. And then they'll be delivered. I'll bring them out with much possession. With wealth, I'll bring them out, he says. God promised. And so God remembered. 400 years later, God looked at the calendar and said, well, it's time. Let me go and deliver. And God comes down to Moses and meets him as he takes care of his sheep out in the wilderness. He says, Moses, come here to the burning bush. He said, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Let me introduce myself to you. I have not forgotten you people. Your people's cry has reached out to me, and I have come down to deliver them. I want you to go speak to Pharaoh. Tell that Pharaoh to let my people go. And finally, after much struggle, Moses agrees to do that, goes and gets his brother Aaron. He goes before Pharaoh and tells them, let my people go. This is what my God said. He says, tell your God, I am not going to let them go. Because the Egyptian economy was dependent upon these slaves. They were building big buildings and so on. And these people were working for free, slave labor, cheap labor. And he was not about to let them go. He said, no, we're not going to let them go. So God sent one plague after the other, starting with a soft one. And increased the intensity of the plague. As Pharaoh hardened his heart more and more and more, God showed some intensity in the kind of plague that he sent. 9 plagues came and went, but Pharaoh would not let them go. And the 10th plague God is going to send. And in all the 9 plagues that came, none of the plagues affected the Israelites. The plagues affected the life of the Egyptians only. The Israelites, God drew a line between the Israelites and the Egyptians and said, these are my people and these are Egyptians. These are the persecutors of my people. He drew a line, blessed them and sent the plague over on them. 9 times. And now 10th time, the biggest plague is going to come where the firstborn of every house is going to die. But the thing is, Israelites are also living in the land. So how to tell the difference between Israelites and Egyptians? So to mark the difference, God says, go get a lamb, bring that lamb, keep it for 4 days, then kill that lamb and catch the blood in a basin and take a plant called hyssop, a bunch of it, dip it into it and smear the blood on the doorpost and the lintel. It will be a sign that you are my people. And when the destroyer comes, he will not be allowed to enter into that house. The sign must be on the door outside. You sit inside. If you are inside, you will not be touched by the plague. This is the arrangement that God has made. Now, God is now going to deliver about 2 million people from slavery. Imagine that day, all that happened, they bought the lamb, kept it for 4 days, they're cutting the lamb, shedding the blood. You know, everything pictures Christ. It's about Christ. Why did he tell them to buy it 4 days before and keep the lamb 4 days? Because the lamb will come into their house, the children will love it, they will play with it, they will love it, and they'll hate to cut it. Because they love the lamb so much. I've had that problem too. I bought one lamb one time and took it home, and I thought I'll grow it in Christmas time, we'll kill it, or some occasion we'll kill it. But my family won't allow me to kill it, because they said, no, that's our lamb. You go buy some other lamb, you know. I said, that's what I bought it to eat, make biryani, you know. I said, nothing doing, not this one. This is ours. So I had to go get something else and send this somewhere else, you know, for biryani somewhere else. But the thing is, see how thoughtful God teaches it. He says, 4 days you must keep it in your home till all the children, the whole family loves it, and then kill it, to show that if you would love a lamb that's been with your family for 4 days, how much more God loves his only begotten son. That he will send his son and make him die on the cross of Calvary and make him shed his every drop of blood to save you and redeem you. Look at what God is willing to do for you. That's the teaching there. So look at the thing that happened there. They cut the lamb, shed the blood, smeared the doorpost, and get inside the house and eat the meat of the lamb inside. If you ask them that day, they probably never understood anything that they were doing. Probably some of them are hearing my sermon today. For the first time, they're understanding what happened there. They probably had no idea of what this was all about. They had killed some lambs before as a sacrifice, because they knew that when you come before God, you got to admit that you're a sinner and the soul that sins shall die. So you killed the lamb, shed the blood, and showed that you're a sinner and came through the blood. That's how much they understood. But this whole process of smearing the blood on the doorpost, sitting inside, eating the meat, with your shoes on, with your clothes on, and with your stick ready, all ready to go. They don't understand what this is. What this depicts, they had no idea of. But we, looking back from the New Testament days, from the days after Christ and his work on the cross, we look back on the Old Testament. Now we perfectly understand. That's why I read 1 Corinthians 5:7. Paul says, Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. We don't have to interpret that Passover is Christ or it depicts Christ. Paul does it for us. We just go take it from there. Paul says, you remember the Passover there? Christ is our Passover. That lamb was their Passover. For us, Christ is our Passover. He has been sacrificed for us. In other words, he says, take a good look at Passover. You will understand what Christ is all about, what he has done, and what that means to you today. So, what does it mean? When that Passover lamb was killed and the blood was smeared, the first thing that was given was protection. Protection. Protection from what? Every child, male, every firstborn is going to die. In every house, man and animals going to die. But in the Israeli house, everyone is safe as long as they are under the blood. They go behind the door of the blood-stained door of the house and stay inside. They are safe. This is protection. Protection from what? Protection not only from the death on that day, from the danger that was to come to every house on that day, but protection in our sense, looking at it now, protection from the judgment of God that is going to come one day, when all those that are not under the blood are going to judge by God, are going to enter into second death. That is a horrible thing. An eternity without God. We are going to be spared from that. We are safe from that. That is depicted there. But also, it depicts the fact that the blood of Jesus marks us as very special people. That God even protects us from our present dangers of this life. It speaks of protection in this life. Because when those people came out of that house and traveled on their way to the promised land, never God allowed anybody to lay their hands on him, on them. Because it was not just until they were inside that house, they were okay. Even when they got out of the house and came out of the land, they were under the blood's protection. the blood remained as a wall round about them. On that day, they had to remain under the inside the house. But after that, they left. But when they left, the blood stain or the blood mark was upon them. They were marked to show that they were God's people, that they are special. Just like in all the plagues never touched the Israelites. He never allowed any danger to even come near them. Total protection. That's why you remember Balaam comes and wants to curse them. The king has brought him to curse them. And he opens his mouth to curse them, and he could hardly get his mouth open. And when the words finally come out, blessing is only coming out. He is not able to curse them. He says, how can I curse what God has blessed? God takes control of his mouth itself and makes him speak blessings over his people. Amazing story. Because they are blood marked. No danger can come upon them. God protects them. God builds a wall of protection round about them. Now I understand what the Pentecostals meant when they said, keep him under the blood, Lord. See, when they said, let him be under the blood, under the covering of the blood, cover him with your blood, they will pray. You know, those days I understood very little, you know. I said, what kind of prayer is that? Cover him under your blood, you know. And then they'll say, I sprinkle the blood of Jesus. I said, what does that mean, you know? That's what it means. What they're saying is, Lord, you redeemed us by your very blood. You shed every drop of blood for us. Your precious blood, sinless, holy blood was shed because you considered us precious. You shed your precious blood, gave your life. You're not going to leave us, are you? When we are in trouble, you're going to protect us. You're going to shield us. You're going to guard us. You're going to raise a wall around about us, protect us from all the evil and the danger and all the works of the enemy. We count on your protection because the day that we put our faith in Jesus as our Lord and confessed him as our Lord and thereby took that blood and smeared it upon the doorposts of our heart, we became, just like the people of Israel, a protected people, a blood-marked people whom God protects. That's the meaning of that. There's protection. Secondly, there is deliverance. The second thing is deliverance. Now, deliverance is not an ordinary thing. Consider these people. 430 years. Horrible years. How long can you put up with trouble like that? How long can you live under slavery? One generation after the other, they're living under slavery. Totally demoralized. Completely exploited, considered like dirt, treated like nothing. One generation after the other, they live under the agony of this slavery and want and need and fear and terror. You ask those people what deliverance means to them. Even today, the Jewish people, when they sing about that deliverance.
Put our hands together. These are some awesome days that we live in, right? These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of the servant Moses, righteousness being restored.
Those days are great triumphs,
famine and darkness and sore. Still hear a voice in the desert crying, preparing the way of the Lord.
Behold, he comes riding on clouds, shining like sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation
comes. These are the days of Ezekiel,
my bones becoming his flesh. These are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise.
These are the days of the harvest. The fields are as white in the world.
We are the laborers in your vineyard,
declaring the word of the Lord.
Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, this year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation.
Behold,
behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, this year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
There's no God like our God. See it.
There's no God like Jehovah. 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 There's no God like Jehovah.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah.
Behold, he comes,
riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, this year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation.
Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun.
At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, this year of Jubilee.
Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.